And good afternoon. It's Thursday, the 2nd of February, 2017. And I wanted to get that right today because I got the date and the day completely wrong yesterday. I said it was the 1st, which was correct. But I said it was Tuesday and it was Wednesday. And I said it was 2016 and it was 2017. Not only that, but Gustav with the beady eye. I'm surprised someone didn't pull me up on that one. Jerry, who is a regular correspondent to this programme, usually warns me if there has been an error. Delete, delete, delete. An error, 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 error. He usually warns me if there's been some sort of error or something like that. So, sorry about that. Got that wrong. And also, yesterday, Gustav noticed that the mirror ball wasn't turning and the light wasn't on. It was all very slapdash yesterday. Very, very disappointed. Believe me, I'm as disappointed as you were. Now, listen, I've moved the mic. Oh, you can still see that. I've moved, because of the wide screen now on our live camera, you can see that you could see the microphone. This, here's the microphone here, you see. And it was, it's a bit, it's drooping a bit. Look, we've got a bit of a droop on the microphone. So I'm trying to kind of move it out of the way. Can you, I'm assuming you can still hear me all right. If you can't, could you pop over a little message nice and quickly and I'll sort that out, OK? Also, a couple of people, just two things before we start proper today. A couple of people have said, do we see you? If we're watching live, do we see you kind of exactly at the point where you've spoken? No. There is, throughout the internet, round about something between a 7 and a 10 second delay. Today it's 9 seconds. OK, it's 9 seconds. So I speak and then 9 seconds later you see me. All right, that's how it all works. Also, those of you that are regular viewers and watch the whole show, the thing that I have done for you, those of you that sent through your addresses, is now on its way. They were posted all this morning. Everyone that sent me an address, all those are on their way this morning. Although there was one lady who asked and didn't send me her address. What was her name now? Let me look. I think it began with G, I think. Was it? Let me see if I can find her name. Lady in the States in Pennsylvania, 6500. Pennsylvania, 65000. Is that the song? I'll see if I can find her name for you. Although this email thing's playing up a little bit. So that's that. So they're on the way. 7 second delay. Apologises. Good. We can start now. Greetings, boys and girls. Let's say hello to some of the people who are with us nice and early today. Wendy's with us. Good afternoon, Wendy. Welcome along. Tim says, didn't they use this music once on the television? Yes, Tim. Yes, they did. Well spotted, Tim. Very well spotted. You probably haven't heard that music for about 30 years, have you? But yes, that is absolutely correct. Not ITV, that was the other one. All right. Danny Davis is with us. Good afternoon, Danny. Yours is on its way. Wendy, yours is on its way. Tim says he's just doing random icons, waiting for the show to start. Do you like my little diamonds and things like that? It's very wonderful, isn't it? Gustav says, I hope he turns the sound up on the phone calls. Yes, the button is pushed. It might be an idea, Gustav. Whenever we start now a live show, it might be a good idea to put that little message on. Don't forget to push the button for the phone calls, because otherwise, when a phone call comes through, you can't hear properly, can you? As we found out yesterday. Thank you, Gustav. Correct, Tim. That is the other bit of music. That is correct. It's actually written by a guy called Mr. Arnold. Damn. His name's gone right out of my head now. Mr. Arnold. Oh, damn. His name has gone right out of my head. How annoying is that? Oh, maybe it's over here. Just a moment. Let me just reach over to my little pile of compact discs over here. There it is. There it is. Hang on. There it is. Oh, his name's not on. Yep. David. David Arnold. David Arnold wrote that piece of music. And a few months ago, at the end of last year, I wrote to him and asked if I could have permission to use it, because it's a very old piece of music. It used to be used on Radio Mercury, the Heart of the South. And he wrote back, and I said, how much would that cost? And he wrote back and said, please feel free to use it free of charge. Isn't that nice? He wrote to me, David Arnold, and he wrote scores for James Bond and stuff like that. So that's correct. That's quite correct. That's where that music comes from, Tim. All right. Hello to Matt this afternoon. Good afternoon to Matt Joplin. How lovely to see you not drunk for change, Matt. It really is. Gustav says, is James O'Brien on right now? Well, if he is, go and listen to it. You're in the same boat as him, aren't you? Aren't you one of those lefties? Eh? Are you one of those lefty lovies? You are, aren't you, Gustav? I can tell, lovey. Go on, go and listen to him. See what I care. I don't care, dear. Go, just go. No need to announce that he's on there. Go. Hello to Jerry. Hello, Jerry. You missed something yesterday, Jerry, didn't you? You missed something, yes. You've missed it again this afternoon, haven't you? Right at the beginning, I gave you a name check for some reason. But what was it? You'll have to go back later and see what it was, okay? Hello to Elaine, who says, nice to see you. I like the shirt. Thank you, Elaine. It's not bad, is it, this one? I've got quite a lot of shirts, actually, near the cupboard. In fact, I think I've got quite a lot of clothes now. I don't really need any other clothes, although I would like a red jacket. I don't have a red jacket. They're quite difficult to find. You can find a cheap old raggy one, you know, but I haven't found a red jacket. If anyone of you are into sort of fashion and, you know, jackets that you think would be suitable for wearing on this programme and at my karaoke and quiz nights, do you know a red jacket, of a decent red jacket anywhere? You know, in the same sort of league as Ted Baker, Ralph Lauren, that sort of thing. If you do, and you could send me a link, I'd appreciate that, and I'll have a look at one of those, all right? Elaine says, I'm not able to watch the entire show because I've got to work. Oh, Elaine. Oh, never mind, darling. You can watch the recording a little bit later on, can't you? Sean Richards is with us this afternoon. Hello, Sean. Jamie Clark. Hello, Jamie. All right. Nice, Jamie. Nice to see you, Jamie. Look, Sean, what's on the way? Where's mine? See, Sean? Sean, it's only for the regular people. Those people that watch whole shows and watch every show. That's what it's for. You see, you've missed something, haven't you? You've missed a show, or if you missed part of a show, so you won't know what it is. Not going to tell you. Not going to tell you, lovey. Wendy says, you could put your clock on from Australia or New Zealand on the wall now. We could see it with your new camera. Yes, I could, couldn't I? Now, the thing is, where is it? This is from Norfolk Island. Let me just get this. Here's my Norfolk Island clock, which I did some work. My cousin Vince was running the police on Norfolk Island a number of years ago. Actually, 2010 this is. Gosh, 6 years ago. And I went over there and I'd done a little disco for the, first of all, for the little people, sort of under 10, I suppose. And then for the teenagers while I was over there. And they gave me this clock, and there's plenty of space here for this now, isn't there? Look, I can put that right, I can go right over there, can't it? Look, plenty of space for the old Norfolk Island clock now. So that will be going on the wall, Wendy. All right, darling. Hello to Tony Power this afternoon. Hello, Tony, welcome along. Tim says it's Sheila Fogarty on now, so I'm not tuning over. Thank you, thank you. Hello to Alan. Good afternoon, Chris. Great night last night, including the weirdest thing with the laptop. Now, here's a question for you, boys and girls. We got a technical question for you this afternoon, if you can help us with this. Now, Alan popped over to the quiz last night. A little bit quiet, the quiz last night. Disappointing. We had about, I think we had five teams to start with, and we ended up with four. But, you know, there's three prizes, so you had a good chance of winning a prize, really. That's nice, a lovely night, though. Nice people in there, nice people. Anyway, so Alan came over last night, and I wanted to give him some files, okay? And I've got this hard drive, right? So it's, this is, hang on a minute, let me take the bloody wires off, honestly. So it's a hard drive, right? Like USB hard drive. It's not a purpose-built USB hard drive. You take the top off. I've showed you this before. You take the top off, right? And you get the damn thing off. Okay, and basically, it's like a case. That's called a caddy, a hard drive caddy, right? It's got a plug there. And you take your hard drive and you plug it in. Like that. And you push it all the way to the front. You put the top on. Then you attach one wire into the back and plug the other one. I can't get a damn lid on now. There we are. You attach the wire in the back there. First of all, you plug it into the electric, right? And then you plug this into the back of that, and then you plug that into your USB computer, and it comes up as a hard drive. Simple as that. Now, this works on my... I can plug it in here now, and it will immediately appear. It will immediately appear. Or I plug it into my laptop and it appears on there. And I put some files on there for Alan's computer. He brought his laptop over. I actually gave him the hard drive on Monday night. And he brought his laptop and he rung me up and he said, I can't get this to work. I said, what do you mean you can't get it to work? He said, well, it's plugged in, but I can't see anything. I said, wait, can you see the hard drive? And he said, no. I said, have you pushed a little button on the back? He said, yes, that was on. So last night, I've got itchy mouth, itchy roof in the mumper. Yes, bud. So he brought the laptop over to the pub last night, along with the hard drive. And sure enough, I plugged that into, I said, right, fire up your laptop. And I kind of did it in at the end of the night. We plugged the laptop in, that all fired up, plugged that in, nothing. It doesn't come up as a hard drive or anything. So I went into my computer and all you could see was the C drive. Very strange. So I then went into disk management and you could see his drive and another drive. But there was no letter assigned to it and you couldn't assign a letter to it. You would click on it and nothing would happen. Everything would be greyed out. So does anyone know why that is? I have to tell you that I'm running Windows 10 on all my devices, no problems. He's got Windows XP. Does that make any difference at all? And yet, I then put some of the files onto a USB stick. I've got something like this, right? Like a USB stick. Put some of the files in it from my computer. Then I plugged that into his computer. Now, that worked. That worked. He could see the files and indeed the drive, but not on the external hard drive. So if anyone has any idea why that was and how I mean, we don't need to do it now because we've done it, you know, but how would I get around that if that ever happened again? Then I'd be very interested in knowing that. OK, perhaps you'd like to ring in and tell me this afternoon. I have a phone line that is open now, boys and girls. A local London number, 020-8144-3477. OK, 020-8144-3477. It's a local London number if you want to call in. I've also got Skype as well. If you want to Skype in, my Skype username is all one word, United Kingdom Talk. That's the info there. If you've got any ideas why that is, or perhaps just put a message underneath this show or send an email, chris@unitedkingdomtalk.co.uk. OK, hello to John Springate, who is 67. Are you 67 now? Because you've got a little 67 picture next to you. He says, United Kingdom Talk not working. Well, it is. I'm here. How can it not be working? We're here. Gustav says, I'm not getting one either, but there would be danger of getting impetigo from the packaging. What's impetigo? I've no idea what that is. What on earth is impetigo? I don't know what that is. I'm sorry. I've no idea what impetigo is. Please do tell us. OK, and as I say, I'd be very interested to find out what the problem is there on that thing, if you know, indeed. Joey, I did tell instructions on how to receive one of those in a previous show. I gave explicit instructions on what to do. So, you know, were you not paying full attention to it? Do try and pay full attention to everything going on around you. All right. Here's something else to talk about this afternoon, boys and girls. Now, my best mate, Ronny, who won't be with us this afternoon, he doesn't watch these programmes. Now and again, he'll... Oh, by the way, I came home last night. I must tell you, I came home last night. You know that setting I was looking for? I found it. And it, as always, you know, it was hidden away. The thing is with computer programmes, there's so many different settings, especially with audio and visual stuff. And you just... You do something. You spend ages trying to find something, find out how to do something. I mean, hours, literally hours. Eventually, you thought, all right, that's it. And you do it, right? But then, a day later, you can't find it again. Have you heard that before? Oh, it's a nightmare, isn't it? Absolute nightmare. Anyway, I came home last night. I did a little bit of searching on the internet and I came back and the setting I was looking for was in fact there and I found it. The setting was to do with the synchronization between the audio and the picture. My mouth wasn't moving at the same time, but we found that a couple of days ago. So I think we've sorted all that out now, boys and girls. Okay. Now, let's have a look. Here's something else for you to talk about this afternoon, boys and girls. If you fancy a phone call, nasty procedures. Medical procedures, dentist or bodily operating theatres, anything like that. Have you had any nasty medical procedures? So you're, oh, I really don't want that done again. And I ask you that this afternoon because my mate has just had one just a couple of hours ago. I'm not sure what he went in for now. It'll either be his stomach or his back. He has problems with both of them. I think it's one of those two things. And he's just been to the hospital, the Royal Berkshire Hospital, which is just, it's not too far away from here. And he's had to go in a scanner. And I said, what's it like? He said, it is the smallest tube. And you go in there and lay down like this. You may well have had one of these yourself. And if you have, I now know what you've gone through. You lay flat on your back in this scanner and you go in. And he said, Chris, the roof is like 2 inches from you like that. And you feel completely and utterly trapped. My mother certainly wouldn't have been able to do something like that. I don't know how you do something like that. You'd have to completely switch off in your mind, wouldn't you? Because you can't move. And for 45 minutes, you can't move in this machine. Oh, my word. I mean, that is just frightening to me. Have you had anything done like that that you'd like to talk about this afternoon? I'd love to know. 020-8144-3477 is my phone number. Any sort of experience like that. 45 minutes, you've got the roof there. I suppose your arms are like that. Presumably it's not very comfortable in there. I don't know if it's hot in one of these things or anything like that. I did ask if he wanted to come on and talk about it, but he didn't. And then they pulled him out. He was in there for about 40 minutes, he said. Then they pulled him out, injected him with something, and then pushed him back in again for another 25 minutes. Oh, my Lord. It's just awful. I mean, of course, but a necessary thing. Not only that, to add insult to injury, when he came out, he said to the nurse, did you see anything on there? At what point? The nurse says, yes, we did, but we can't tell you anything about it. We're not allowed to tell anything about it. I mean, fancy that. Fancy you coming out of something like that and then saying to the nurse, did you see anything? She said, yes, but we can't talk about it. I mean, why say that? That is ridiculous. Better to say nothing at all. I'm sorry, we're not allowed to, we don't understand, we're just doing the photographs, and then let you go. Now, of course, that all that's on his mind, you know, they've seen something and he doesn't know what it is. Horrendous. Hello to Danny Davis calling in from Wrexham in Wales. Hello, Danny.
Good afternoon.
All right, how are you today?
I'm all right, thanks. I've given myself a new name.
Oh, what's that?
The technology correspondent.
Technology correspondent. Danny Davis is on the air today. Hello, Danny Davis.
Hello.
I've got my phone button pushed today, Danny, so everyone can hear you in full stereo for those of you with suitable encoders.
That's good. So I'm all around everybody's ears.
You're around everyone's ears. Is this to do with my USB hard drive? Let me get it down here.
Yes, it is.
Go on then.
Basically, when the hard drive was in the computer, mm-hmm. was it? I take it was a D drive, wasn't it? Or what letter was it?
Well, I don't know. A C drive. This was the main hard drive.
That's why then, because it was classed as a C drive, because C drive is the main hard drive for the computer. If it was any other hard drive, then
well, no,
it's got program files on it.
It was reformatted.
But it's still got program files on it.
It's got nothing on it at all.
Even when you reformat it, it's still got a trace on it.
Has it? Oh, right, okay. Yeah. Well, yeah, but why does it work in my laptop and not his?
Because your computer and your laptop are running Windows 10. So if your computer is using Windows 10...
Yes.
The Windows 10 trace will still be on that hard drive.
I mean, you can see, the only place you could see it was to go into disk management, and there you could see his hard drive. I don't know, Hitachi or something like that. And I knew it was my hard drive because it was the same size. It's only a 500 meg one, this one. It's not a massive, or 500 gig, I think it, which comes up as 465 or something like that. I don't know. And so I could see it there, but you couldn't do anything to it.
Because it's got the traces of Windows 10.
Oh, I see.
In such an old version of Windows.
XP is not even supported anymore, is it, XP?
No, they've stopped the updates for that now as well. So
right.
That's why. But when you put the files onto a flash drive, the mini, whatever you want to call it, because the files are particular files, they're now supported because they're not. Because it's not a whole hard drive. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Well, yes, it does. Is there a way of making that drive completely blank then, or what?
You can't physically do it because obviously if you do that, everyone, that's why, you know, I'm going to go into a little bit of depth. You know, when a police take your computer away for any unbeknown reason.
Well, it's never happened to me, dear.
But what I'm saying is police can take your computer away.
I've seen that, yes.
Even if you've deleted the files 10, 20 years ago.
Oh, like on the films, and they can find them again, can't they? Yes, yes.
Yeah, yeah. So that's why there's also,
know that. So what about my, I've given away stuff before where I've blanked the hard drive, right? Mm. Obviously, because all my passwords and banking things. So that could be retrieved, could it, in some way?
If you've got a special program, yeah, special program, and because they're obviously cyber experts, aren't they? So they'll send it to an expert.
But generally, if I put one of these on a rubbish tip, you know, it's not really of any interest to the police or anything like that. So normal people wouldn't be able to get that information, would they?
No, no one would be able to know how many millions you've got in the bank now.
There's not millions in the bank. Dear me, I wish there was. I'll keep buying the bloody lottery ticket, shall I?
Yeah, keep buying the lottery ticket. But that's the reason why they didn't work, because the file's not because Windows 10's obviously a higher spec running system than what XP is. So
that's
if you wanted to transfer a music file, you could put it onto a flash drive and it transfer straight away.
Yes, that worked. That's what I did. That worked fine. So that's worth knowing. And I did say to him, maybe it's because you've got an old computer. It was XP. I mean, that's really old now, isn't it? XP, I suppose.
Yeah, he wouldn't be able to go up to 10.
Right.
He wouldn't be able to go from XP because it was 7 then, wasn't it? Vista, then 7,
yes.
Then 10.
Okay.
So there's three operating systems after XP.
All right.
So he'd need to get a new laptop. The horrifying... I've had an MRI scan before.
Have you really?
Yeah, I had to have one on my
head. I tell you what, Ronnie's trying to call in now. Let me see if I can add him to the group, all right?
Okay.
One second. Hello, Ronnie?
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. I'm not a first-time caller. The Chris Reardon show.
Oh, Danny, you've gone on hold. How do I do this? Just a second. Right. Ron, can you call in after Danny?
My brother Danny?
No, another Danny's on the phone. I got his call first, so call in after him, all right? Then we can talk about your thing.
Thank you.
Hang on. No, stay there. Merge calls. Does that work? Danny, you there? Danny? Ronnie?
I'm here.
Oh, he's hung up. Oh, okay.
Oh, what a shame.
Danny's hung up. Okay, so we've lost Danny now.
Sorry, Danny.
No, sorry, Danny, I tried to do something technical then and it didn't quite work. Never mind. We apologise on behalf of the network and
amateur.
My conglomerated organisations.
Amateur.
Huh? What do you mean amateur?
Amateur.
Anyway, this is best friend Ron. Tell us about your experience today.
Hello.
Oh
hang on, Danny's there now. How comes you're back?
Because I had to join an ongoing call, that's why.
Oh, was that it? Well, Ron is just going to tell us now about his experience. Say hello to him.
Hello, Ronnie.
Hello, Danny.
Oh, that works, doesn't it? So you tell us about yours then, and Danny's got one as well, all right?
Okay, well, I'll go and let Danny finish, and I'll call back in a minute.
Okay, that would be very cool. Then you can tell us exactly what happened, because I've probably got half of it wrong anyway, haven't I?
Sorry to have interrupted you, Danny. I do apologise.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
It's okay, don't worry.
No problem. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Cheerio. I'll speak to you in a minute. All right, Danny, tell us, what was your procedure?
Well, my procedure was an MRI scan, which is like a big polar mint, isn't it? So I had to go for a scan on my head.
Right. What was this for?
Because I...
To see if you had a brain?
Well, they do ask that and they often wonder, but there's something there.
Didn't find anything, though.
They didn't find anything. Because I had a car accident many years ago.
Hmm.
And the procedure is that once you have a car accident, if you hit your head, they have to send you for an MRI scan.
Okay.
And then they found some sort of, like, not a growth, but there seemed to be some sort of blockage between my ear and my brain. So in one of my ears, I'm actually deaf, completely deaf. And this is from a car accident. And there's nothing they can actually do for me, which is pretty scary, really.
But what's it like being in that tube? Is it like a narrow tube? That's what Ronny was saying. We'll get him in a minute to call in and he can tell us exactly. Was that the same for you? Was it a narrow tube or something?
Yeah, it's a narrow tube. They give you like a helmet or something to put on.
Right.
And then it sounds like an aeroplane engine just whirring around.
Yeah.
And it gets louder and louder, and it's really distracting. But I had a choice of like 10 different albums to listen to.
Bring your own music in then? You could bring in talk shows of me. That would take your mind off it, wouldn't it, dear?
Well, there was already music there, so I had one of Michael Jackson's number one albums. You know the number one albums he brought out.
Yeah,
so I had that on. So I was listening to that, and they were scanning, and I was in there for about 30 to 40 minutes.
Oh, so quite a considerable amount of time.
And it is quite scary because even though you've got the music on, you can still hear it because it's that loud.
Right.
And all these lights are going on. It's like the Starship Enterprise.
Okay.
With all the lights. It is quite scary. And then obviously they can't tell you anything because the doctor's got to look at it. And like you said, it makes you wonder what have they found. If there's anything there. And then I went back to a doctor and he said, yeah, you've got a blockage and this has been caused by a car accident. And I thought,
yes,
how can a car accident cause a blockage?
Yeah.
Because it's between the ear and the brain, there is nothing they can do for it. They can't open it up and like kind of clear it. They can't shove anything up because of the eardrum. Mm.
Cleaners. I mean, can't you just shove a pipe cleaner in there and clear it out, dear?
I don't think they can, but they said there's no medication, there's no like antibiotics
or
anything to get rid of it. It's just literally a block up. So it sometimes if, you know, I clean my ears out every day because the doctor said to clean your ears out every day.
What, with pipe cleaners?
No, with cotton wool buds, you know, cotton wool buds twice a day, once in the morning, once in the evening before you go to bed.
You're not supposed to put cotton wool buds in your ears.
You know,
Very bad.
You know, the little stick things.
You're not supposed to put those in your ears. Very bad indeed. The doctor told me that. He said, never, ever put those in your ears.
Well, the doctor told me to put
that
in my
ears. There's a reason your finger will only go in so far. God made it like that so you couldn't damage your eardrum, dear.
Well, I'm taking the doctor's advice, so I clean it out once in the morning when I get up and once before I go to bed, just to keep the everything. But the saying is, never put anything bigger than your elbow in your ear.
No. All right, Danny. Well, thank you for telling us of your experience, sir. Much appreciated, sir.
Thanks, Chris. I'll speak to you soon.
Cheerio. Goodbye, Wales. Wexham, Wales. Ronnie, you can call in now. We're ready for you now. Couple of messages coming through. Rod Brown, hello Rod, says, Chris, I could write a book on my medical experiences. Well, get it written, dear. It'd be a lot more interesting than that crap Katie Price and the various people like that keep writing. So boring. Wendy says, the nurse should never have said anything to Ronnie. Hello, Ronnie.
No, she shouldn't have. She's really upset me.
Yeah. So tell us, what happened today?
So they found a lump on my elbow.
Oh, it's on your elbow. I beg your pardon. Yeah, okay.
Yeah. So first of all, they thought it was tennis elbow. But then I saw a doctor, and she went and got a consultant because they was looking at my elbows, and they were saying that one of them's not the correct shape. So I had an x-ray. That didn't show anything, so they said, right, you've got to have an MRI. So I went to the MRI today, and it's like a big polo, and you lay down on the bed. Now, they raised the bed really high, so my head was near enough touching the top of the machine.
Oh.
Now, the end of the machine was just above my head.
And this is just for
the way down my body. It went all the way down my body to my knees. So it was really high, so it was very claustrophobic. It made me feel very, very sick.
But this was just for your elbow, was it?
This is for my elbow, yeah.
Why do you have to have everything, like, why can't they just put something around your elbow? I don't understand.
Because the whole machine obviously takes a picture of everything, and then they just hone in on what part they want to look at.
Oh, right, okay.
Like the other guy was saying, that, you know, I was listening to music. You can't hear it because of the noise of the machine. I had earplugs in, and it's banging and whirling and making all noises, like, you know, and it goes on and on, and it's like 30 or 40 minutes. But then they had to inject some dye into me, and that made me feel really sick.
Does that go in your arm?
Yeah.
Right.
But that's happened before before they've done the operation on my stomach.
Right.
They've done that, and I was sick with that one as well. But not a nice experience. So then, sort of getting ready, I said to the nurse, "Did you see anything?" She said, "Yes." And I said, "Oh, what is it?" "Oh, well, I'm not allowed to comment."
Oh, that's ridiculous. Well, I would complain about that.
Is it sinister? "Oh, I'm not allowed to say." And I'm like, "Well, why tell me there's something there and then not tell me what it is?"
That's
hideous. Not allowed to.
Oh, that's awful.
So they're allowed to say there's something there, but they're not allowed to say what it is.
My guess is they're not allowed to say there's anything there. That is just going to do is worry you now. When's your appointment, the next thing?
Oh, the 14th. It's only a couple of weeks away.
Only? So for 2 weeks you're going to sit there and worry now, aren't you? And no, every time you feel a little twinge in that arm, you're going to think it's got worse.
Well, no, with my arm, every time I move it, it hurts. Every time, if I bump it on something, it is excruciating. It is so painful. It is so, so painful. But they're saying it's not tennis elbow. So I don't know what it is.
Mm.
I don't know. It's very, very painful to move. It's very painful.
I'm sure it is.
You know, I've been through quite a lot. You know what I've been through. Stuff that I've had done.
Talk into the phone, dear. You're moving away from the phone then.
I am still in the same position as I was just now.
Well, you'll hear that on the playback now. I'll be able to prove to you that you've moved your phone.
I didn't move the phone.
You're running around the room in small pants, aren't you? That's what's going on,
no,
dear.
No, I'm on my sofa, relaxing.
With the cats.
With the heating on.
You know what would make...
And a couple of cats.
You know what would make you feel better? If you came round here for a bowl of butterscotch angel delight.
Oh, no, I'll probably throw up everywhere.
Which is in my fridge. Oh, by the way, the cat has been. Oh, let me just tell you, boys and girls, I was a little bit concerned because Katie the cat, as you, if you're a regular viewer, you know, she's quite old now and she's a bit incontinent, both sort of things, you know. And she hasn't...
Well, she's called that from you.
And then I noticed, I thought she hadn't been for a couple of days. Well, I say a couple of days. I didn't see her go yesterday, and I haven't seen her to go today. And, you know, it's important to see her go once a day. And I said to Ronnie earlier, I don't think she's gone. But when I came back in, I looked under the table, and there it was. On the newspaper! Yes! On the newspaper at last!
Bringing back the Katie cam. It's more popular than you.
It is? We had a camera set up the other night on the cat. Literally placed on the floor, looking at the cat. And it got more viewers than this programme gets. That's absolutely true. This colour programme on BBC One Colour. Yes.
Yep. Bless it, little Katie. Bless her.
Poor little Katie. So she has been, and she went on the newspaper. It's because she has been going on the kitchen floor, but she went on the newspaper. I've literally covered half of the kitchen floor now in newspaper, which is a bit inconvenient, but it's for the best, isn't it?
Well, I mean, I thought you was going to start wallpapering the walls with it, seeing as it's so cheap.
No, I'm doing that with £20 notes, mate.
With £20 notes?
Yes.
No, I can't see that. I can see you doing it with newspaper because it's cheap. Slum. Slum.
Slander. That's what you are, slanderous. Slanderous. Do you like my poncietta? It's looking a little bit worse for wear. I think it's still holding on, dear. It's still holding on. We might get another week or so out of it. I don't know yet.
Yeah. What was really bad, after cleaning Katie's feet the other day, you wanted to reuse tissue.
Oh, poor little, yeah. Because when I told you the other day, boys and girls, I told you she'd gone and then she'd walked around and around in it. And the mess was unbelievable. And I realised yesterday, of course, the camera's gone funny. Oh, don't say that's going to start playing up. Live camera's gone a bit funny. It's jumping.
Oh, here we go. Amateur.
Now, I thought we'd sorted out that problem.
Oh, dear.
We'll carry on. Still all right, is it? Still all right, yeah. Yes, and of course, her paws were dirty, so we cleaned those yesterday, didn't we? She didn't like that, did she?
No, she bit me. Oh,
she bit me. She bit me. Look, I got marks on my hand where she... Actually, there is marks on my hand where she bit me, I think. Either that or they're freckles, one of the two. Well, thank you for calling in and telling us about your experience.
That's all right.
Next time you have something like that done, can I bring in the camera and film it?
No. Have you told them all about my new tattoos?
Oh.
More tattoos done, more ink work.
Too many tattoos.
I now have a full sleeve.
He's got a full arm of tattoos. Well, you'll have to show us next time we do a recorded show, all right?
No. Oh, okay then. I'll go, shall
I? Well, you can't exactly show them now, can you?
No, but...
Well, there you go, then.
Tell them about it.
Well, go on then, tell them.
No, it's all right, we'll do it on a recorded show.
Okay, bye.
Obviously, it's a Chris Reardon show, so obviously it's all about you.
Yes, it is. Bye-bye. Cut him off. Thank you very much. Always trying to get one over on me, that boy. There we are. That's Ronny's experience in the old tube. Not a nice experience at all. Hello to Dino this afternoon, who's joining us. Jason Alexander say, my fingers go in deeper than most. Well, I don't know about that. How far do my fingers go in my ear? Let's have a look. We could measure this. So hang on. If I put that in my ear and put that finger there, that's how far my finger goes in my ear. All right. Thank you, John. Thank you, sir. Oh, dear, dear me. Couple of news stories to do today, boys and girls. Let's have a look there. Oh, I've got something. Is that wrong? Has that gone wrong there? Thank you very much to Jeffrey, who sends in a picture of the most hideous jacket. No, I don't think we're going to get that one. That's not what I'm looking at. Not something for £28. I think you're looking at the wrong sort of thing there, Jeffrey. All right, my love. Now, this morning... In many of the papers today, and this might be a bit controversial, you might not agree with me on this one, are pictures of a very naked Beyonce. Now, what is all this about? I have three hearts in the Daily Mail for starting. I have three hearts. Pregnant Beyonce strips naked to show off her baby bump in intimate snaps after announcing she is expecting twins. Now, I'm not being funny. She is completely naked. Completely naked. And I just don't think this is a beautiful thing, seeing this. And people keep getting out baby bumps and showing them. It's not nice. Is it just me who feels this way? How do you feel? Do you think that's quite acceptable to be half naked in there with this bump showing like that? Cover it up, for Christ's sake. I mean, I don't walk around with a crop top on exposing my rather fat belly, do I? Oh, I know, it's not the same thing. That's what you say. I just don't find it nice at all. And she's in the sun as well, in the same thing. The story goes on here. Let me read it to you. In stunning announcement on Wednesday, Beyonce posting just a bra and knickers in an ethereal... what's that word? Ethereal shot. While surrounded by frowns and cradling her bump in an Instagram post, she added the caption, "We would like to share our love and happiness." Well, we don't want to see it. I don't want to see your love and happiness and your naked But it's just awful. Just awful. She's 35, and she says, I've got three hearts emblazoned across in reference to her two babies. Understandable. While giving a rare glimpse into her wedding day, holidays with her family, and stunning behind-the-scenes shots of her life. But there we are. And just horrible. Now, on Loose Women, which is a song that a show that really I don't watch. Let's have a look. Janet Street Porter said on there today, because they showed the picture of Beyonce and this bump and what have you. Why are you all applauding? The audience all started clapping. They all started clapping. Janet Street Porter says, a woman gets pregnant. It's not a miracle. We all know how it happens. And what Janet Street Porter says is she's sewing it to sell more records. How do you feel about seeing that? Is it okay with you? Am I just a bit old-fashioned with that? What's all that about? I don't like to see people with these bumps all over the place. Is it me? What do you think? Put a little message, I'll read it out. Or you can call in if you want to, 020-8144-3477, okay? 020-8144-3477. Or you can Skype in. Our Skype username is all one word, United Kingdom Talk, all right? All one word, United Kingdom Talk for the Skype username there. Let's have a look. Wendy says the camera was jumping, but it's okay now. Yeah, I don't know why it was jumping, though, Wendy. It's a very strange thing. I thought that was all sorted now, but never mind. Hello to Mark Cording, who's with us today. Hello, Mark. Wendy says, has Ronnie got an iPhone 7? Yes. And it's a slight movement away from that microphone, and that's it. It kills it all, doesn't it? You can't hear them anymore. Well, I mean, you can hear them, but not too well. So that's that. Here's something that may happen to you one day, and you need to be aware of this. What to do if an unmarked police car signals you to pull over after a woman was stopped by an imposter? Yes, it could happen to you. Going too fast, are you? Little blue light flashing behind you. This is in today's Sun. It says it's a nightmare scenario. You're signaled to pull over by an unmarked police car late at night. But after coming to a stop, you suspect the man behind the wheel isn't a real police officer. An imposter! An imposter! You have no idea of his intentions or what he wants from you. The scary situation is exactly what happened to a Cornish motorist. She was followed by a silver or blue transit van that had a blue flashing light on the dashboard. When she pulled over, she saw a man wearing a hooded top get out of the car and suspected he was not a genuine police officer. Could happen to you easily. She drove away and reported it to the police, who said she'd done the right thing, according to CornwallLive.com. That must be some sort of police. I'm sorry, I think I must have a sore up my nose. It's really itchy today. This is what you should do, according to the police, in this situation. Does an unmarked police car have the power to stop vehicles? The answer is yes, it does. But the officer must be wearing uniform in order to carry out the stop. So I don't know. I mean, how would you know? You can't always see in that rear view mirror, can you? I mean, in my Toyota, I've got one of those mirrors that stops the glare from these idiots who drive around permanently with their forehead beams on. You know the ones I mean, don't you? Why do they do that? Well, my mirror's got something on it. So when that happens, I don't even notice it anymore. But it does darken down what you see behind you. You can see cars behind you, but you can't necessarily clearly see who's in it. So I might not be able to see that police officer's uniform from my rearview mirror. So I mean, well, I don't know what you'd do there. Do you wait until he comes up next to you and you look in and you clearly see? And on the other hand, how easy would it be to go on eBay and perhaps get a policeman's hat and a uniform? We don't know, do we? We don't know what the exactly thing is supposed to look like. Do the police need a reason to stop me? No, they don't. They can just stop you. I mean, of course, it's quite a thing for me. It happens quite often. I do get stopped on occasions. You know, sometimes I'm minding my own business and I see a policeman and he waves me over and he stops me. And usually they open the door and say, ever so sorry, could we have your autograph? And they like to do selfies with me and all this business, the police force, yeah. television celebrity and all that. That's just one of those things. But for yourself, it would be different, of course, because you're not a celebrity. And it says, no, they don't need a reason. The police have the power to stop any vehicle and ask for your name and date of birth and to see your driving licence, insurance and MOT. They can usually be shown later at police station, you know, because, I mean, I don't carry mine with me, to be honest. Driving licence and MOT. I think you are supposed to, but I don't. You know, because you've got another chance of losing the damn things then, haven't you? They're all in a locked-up cabinet somewhere hidden in this house. Oh, yes. What if I'm not sure it's really a police car? The advice from Devon and Cornwall Police is that anyone unsure whether the car flashing them is the police, then do not stop. Anyone who is not 100% sure it's a genuine police car is advised to drive to the nearest police station or public place, such as a petrol station. In remote areas, the driveway of a clearly occupied house could do it a push. The answer is not to stop anywhere secluded. Okay? I mean, it's interesting to say, you know, if you do a lot of driving, how do you know where the nearest police station is? Easier said than done, yeah? Even if you decide not to stop straight away and have to wait for a safe place to pull over, motorists are advised to signal to the police car that you have acknowledged the request. You know, a little wave like that. Perhaps open your window and say, I want to drive to a police station before I stop. I don't know, something like that. Don't know. Do not drive off at great speed, making the police think you are trying to get away. Keep the doors locked until you're happy it's the police. Have your mobile at hand just in case. You can ask to see the warrant card, which should carry the police officer's name and photograph through the closed window. So that's what to do if you ever get stuck like that, boys and girls. Pulled over. Have you been pulled over? You've been using a mobile phone. Do you know what I saw last night? Beautiful Mercedes car pulled up alongside it. He's watching the bloody television. The driver has a television on his dashboard. And he's watching the television last night. That's the first time I've seen that. My God. I didn't even know you could get a television built into the dashboard. Beautiful car. Silver Mercedes is watching the television in the car. Dear, dear me. Hello to Elaine, who said, Barry Manilow was stopped in the late 1970s after he got his licence. He was followed by a police car who stopped him and asked him for his licence and then said to his friend, I told you it was Barry Manilow. Oh, how funny that is. They just wanted to stop Barry Manilow. How wonderful. I might try that one then. Can I just try to get myself a police's hat? And when Barry's over, I'll stalk his hotel. And then I'll try and flash my lights. Can I have a selfie, please? Hello to Wendy. Wendy says, remember what happened to Adam when he was carrying his driving license and he lost his wallet with it. You see, that's the trouble. You carry all this stuff around with you. It just, you know, you're asking to lose it, aren't you? You really are. Elaine says it does happen a lot in the US. A lot, unfortunately. There have been a lot of women killed in the way of someone pretending to be a police officer. Stopping the car, I don't know, strangle, shot, probably nasty things done to them as well if they're women. You know, very, very worrying. Let's just check your messages there. He didn't think it was funny at the time. What, Barry? I shouldn't think he would. I would be glad of the recognition, to be honest. Something like that. All right. I'll tell you what happened on the way to the swimming pool this morning. There I was. I was actually playing. I had my, I've got itchy ears, itchy nose. What on earth is going on with me? I'm just becoming permanently itchy. Do you think I've got internal fleas? Can you get internal fleas? Don't forget this phone number if you want to call in this afternoon. 020-8144-3477, okay? 020-8144-3477. On the way to the swimming pool today, I was quietly going along. I say quietly. I had my headphones and I had the Barry Manilow Gonzo opening playing. You know, the one that starts with, and I'm Ready to take a chance again. Da-da-da. Ready to put my love on a line with you. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. You know that one. The Gonzo opening. There was. And while I was doing this, there were all these women running at me with prams. It must be some antenatal class or something. When I say running, I mean running. And then they suddenly stopped on the path. I took no note. I kept looking forward and I sang loudly my Barry Manilow. They weren't going to interfere with my enjoyment of Barry Manilow's Gonzo opening. I don't think so. Ow. See? Never put a cotton wool bud in your ear. That's very important. Oh, that's better. Oh, that's so much better. Yes. I continued to sing. Sod them. They stopped in the middle of the path and started doing all these exercises. So can I just walk straight through them? And I carried on singing. At the is Copacabana in that one? No, it's not, is it? When you take a chance again. With you. And then he goes into Daybreak after that, doesn't he? I could probably sing the entire thing for you. I'd love that to appear on karaoke. There might be a way. Actually, I'll have to work on that one. There might actually be a way of removing the vocals from that and then maybe putting the words to it on the karaoke thing. Mark says he can't wait to see Barry Manilow again. Oh, we can't either. But there's nothing planned at the moment. We've got a new album coming up soon, and he has now released the list of tracks on the new album, which I've seen as well. So that's coming out very soon. I don't think we have a date on the new album. Yes, Wendy says, yeah, that's the one that you scared your sister half to death when she got in your new car because it was on full blast. Yeah, well, when I first got my new car, I took it up to my sister's. I said, go on in, sit in it. And she says, how'd you turn it on? I said, you pushed a button. So she's pushing his button. And she said, there's nothing happening. And then suddenly out of the speakers, full blast, came Barry Manilow's Gonzo opening. She frightened the life out of her. I've got that on one of the videos somewhere. So there we are. When do you reckon I might be allergic to dust? I'm sure it's something. I'm sure there's something. I don't know what. What I need, because I actually made Ronny some butterscotch apple angel delight today, because he was coming round this afternoon. Now he's not coming round because he don't feel well. So I'm going to have to just eat it. Waste not, want not, dear. I don't like to leave things in the fridge for too long. So I'm going to eat that myself. Thank you very much. Let's have a look. Now, look at the trash. The trash on Virgin Atlantic plane today. Look at this. A passenger has described the terrifying moment a man started shouting at cabin crew and threatening to open the plane's doors mid-flight. The man became aggressive more than 3 hours into the Virgin Atlantic flight from Gatwick to St. Lucia in the Caribbean. Oh, I've been there. That's a nice place. Say, oh, beautiful, dear. Oh, it's all green and lush and hot and steamy. St. Lucia is a beautiful place. It really is. Better than Barbados. I much preferred St. Lucia to Barbados. We stayed at this resort. Actually, hardly went out of the resort, to be honest. I think it's now called Club St. Lucia, the resort. He threatened, shouted and spat. I mean, you know, and spat at members of the cabin crew, who then had to restrain him at 39,000 feet with the help of fellow passengers. Staff took the rare decision to redirect the plane, landing in Portugal, 2,675 miles away from the destination. This bloke, Alfie Hagman from Cuckfield, West Sussex. Oh, I've driven through there. And his friends were also on the 8-hour flight when the man... Okay, that wasn't him. No, that wasn't him. This is the bloke who's reported it. Alfie said the man was in his 20s and began to cause trouble. He was completely out of it. He was threatening the stewards and the people around it and spitting at them. I mean, they're just disgusting people. And I still say a lot of this behaviour from people is caused by the crap television that we have on now. Big Brother has got a lot to answer for. I mean, all these so-called celebrities that are on there. You're not celebrities, darling. It's a freak show, which makes you all freaks. You've only got to look at the people in there. Freaks. Awful. And it's the sort of behaviour on there. And people watching this, young people, impressionable people, watch this sort of thing on the telly and they think it's perfectly okay to act like that out in public, as isn't the case here. And it's just awful people. There's another one here. Look, another story today in The Sun. A jilted girlfriend got her revenge on her two-timing fella in brutal fashion by sleeping with his dad. This girl was 16 at the time, besotted with Calvin, who was 18, but always suspected his father had feelings for her. When she discovered Calvin had been cheating on her with another girl, she got her end, not her end back. Oh, did I really say that? You see, if this was a recording, I would have cut that bit out now. She got her own back by sleeping with his dad. I mean, you know, bad, very bad for Calvin. That was the boyfriend at the time. He two-timed her, so she wanted to get her own back, which is a completely understandable. But with her dad? Oh, no, dear, no. What surprises me is how do these... I mean, do these people then go to the newspaper? How do these stories get in the newspaper? Do they go to the newspaper and say, I've got a story. I was going out with someone and I got my own back by sleeping with his dad. Can I have £25,000 for that story? Is that how it works? How do the papers come across these stories? And why do we really want to read this sort of thing? Huh? Horrible, isn't it? Danny says, have you heard Judge Dredd song? No, Judge Dredd song. What is that? Judge Dredd song. I don't know what that is. Judge Dredd song about what? That's the question. Judge Dredd song about what? I don't know. Jason sent in a joke here. Let's have a look. Oh, I've read that before. I've read that one out before. It was this blood. I'll tell you what. I will read it again. It's not a joke. This actually happens. People in this I-360, which is this thing in Brighton. You know, it's one of those. You all go in this like thing. Like a round thing, and then the doors close and it goes up and up and up, and then you can see over. And some bloke in there kept blowing off the other day. Oh, just awful being in an enclosed space and all that bad air going around. No, thank you very much. Let's do some messages actually from yesterday's show. On the subject of Doctor Who, Rachel says, David Tennant was sexy as. My favourite has to be John Pertwee. Yeah, mine too. John Pertwee and Tom Baker. I would have trouble choosing between the two. I'd just opt for John Pertwee because that was sort of my first real Doctor Who, really. Joanna says, on the subject of bad drivers, which we were talking about yesterday, you get the vehicle license plate, type of vehicle and call the police and give location of the driver. I've reported crazy drivers and you will be anonymous. Well, I'd like to do that, actually. I mean, somebody, that one yesterday... How can you be watching the telly and driving at the same time? It's bad enough when they're on the phone or I saw last night on the way to work, I saw three people on the phone and one person, two people adjusting sat navs and one person watching the television. You know, you could make a business out of just reporting people to the police, really, couldn't you? But does anything happen? Does anything happen? Is it worth doing that? Dangerous. Dangerous. Joanna also says, I wanted to let you know that I have finally received the star that you sent. Oh, my God, that was weeks ago, that was. Don't it take a long time to get second-class parcels over to the States? She says, what, no batteries? No, there's no batteries enclosed, dear. Well, I had my own rechargeable ones. Want you to know it's now hanging above a beautiful picture of my mum and dad. Oh, that's nice. Over my mantle and fireplace. Looks gorgeous. Thank you very much. I'm glad you like our Christmas star that we gave away to you. And also was talking about one of my friends was given diazepam, because he's got a very bad back at the moment. Adam the plumber, who we spoke to yesterday on the phone. I didn't know what diazepam was. It's a Valium, a muscle relaxer, makes some people drowsy or extremely sleepy. Is taken to relieve his muscle spasms. Does that work quite well, does it? Does it... Does it? Is that like an addictive type thing? Is it? Is that an addictive type thing? Not quite sure what that is. Hello to Kareem. Kareem, how are you? Kareem is a lad who used to come down to Hammersmith Belushi's when I used to DJ there. That's a long time ago now. Nice to see you, Kareem. I think you were doing some promoting, weren't you? Sort of pub promoting or DJ promoting, something like that, a while ago. I gave up most of my DJing. Yes, I'm not too keen on the DJing. Unless it's like a 70s. I don't mind doing a 70s and 80s night now and again. But I don't really do much DJing now. I just stick to my karaoke and my quiz nights. I love doing karaoke nights, as you well know. I think you went to a couple of my karaoke nights, Kareem. Lovely to see you, sir. All right, keep smiling, mate. Danny Davis says, the Judge Dredd song, the one with nursery rhymes. No, I don't really know what you're talking about, to be honest, Danny. Okay. Jerry Green says, you should be Doctor Who. I'd love to be Doctor Who. I would love to be Doctor Who. You just think an offer my... Is the phone going to ring? Do I need to give out my personal number? Hello? Oh, no one there, dear. As always, the phone never rings. Jason says, it helps with the MRI to make you calm taking Valium. Oh, really? So if you go in one of those machines, sometimes they give you Valium to keep you calm. I don't think I'd cope up very well at all in one of those thin tubes, one of those MRI things. All right. Elaine says, did you correct the date of my radio show? Yes, Elaine's doing a Barry Manilow radio show on the station in Israel, but you can get it online. What's the name of the station again, Elaine? And I'll now tell the people. It's now on the 7th of February at 4 o'clock, which is, that's next Tuesday, isn't it? 4 p.m. 4 p.m., Elaine. So that's on a Tuesday. That's on a Tuesday. I'm off on Tuesday, so I might just... Oh, no, hang on. Next Tuesday is my special day, isn't it? I'm going out next Tuesday. My mate's taking me out next Tuesday. That's my little birthday treat. And I'm going to get myself a new iPhone S. I'm going to get an iPhone SE for my birthday, which he's making a contribution to, along with his other half, Andy. All monies are gratefully received, and I shall be purchasing an iPhone SE 64 gigabyte next week. Well, not the 7, because there's some real issues with people, certainly when people make calls to me from an iPhone 7, and I can't hear them properly. Dreadful. Dreadful. I know the SE is all right because our lovely Shania, who's on the Isle of Wight, she's got an SE and that works perfectly all right. So there we are. Grant. So hello, Grant. Grant's got the SE as well. So that's good. And of course, you know, if you go a phone below the brand new one, it's always like £200 or £300 cheaper anyway. So that's that. Plus, I'll get about £75, £100 from my phone to trade it in. I think Ronnie's going to give us some money, so hopefully I'll get away with paying out less than £200 for a phone. I mean, I could never pay. I know that the top iPhone, not the gold encrusted one from Harrods, not that one, but I think the top iPhone, the iPhone, is it seven large or seven? Is it 7 Plus or something like that? I think the top one of that with the 256 gig is like £800. There's no way I wouldn't pay that for a phone. No, not for a phone. Really wouldn't. But I just wanted a little bit of an improvement on this one. It started playing up a little bit now and again, and I think it's time to replace them. I've got an iPhone 5S at the moment. As I say, I'll probably get about £75, £100 from that, from the Apple shop, which Ronnie is already... I said, if you sort it all out for me, so all I've got to do... And we'll be going to Reading Apple Store next Tuesday to collect my new iPhone. And then out for a meal somewhere. Not quite sure where we're going yet, so there we are. Wendy says, glad you're getting the SE. I think they look great. Yeah, basically the same one as the one I've got already, really. Except much... I'm hoping that some of the stuff that I do on it, video-wise, will be a lot quicker to save and that sort of thing. Elaine says, is your birthday Tuesday? No, it's Sunday, actually. My birthday's Sunday. I'll be 54 on Sunday. All right. 54. God's sake, I can't believe it. Can't believe it. Elaine says, I'll post the link on the event page. Yeah. The radio station is Colnessziona. I'll spell it for you. Colnessziona. That's the name of the radio station. OK, so Elaine, the thing is, like, when I say repeat, I mean, I know, but new people who haven't heard you or perhaps even seen me before, won't know anything about that. That's why you find a lot of the time a lot of stuff is repeated, because you never know who's joined us. Someone new, probably never seen me before, probably watching it for, who's this sad old man talking to himself in a little room with lights on? And they've never heard any of this before. That's why you get sort of, I often ask people to repeat things and things like that. You know, and I could say to you, I could say, well, Adam the plumber rang in yesterday. And people say, oh, who's Adam the plumber? They've never heard of him before because they're new. That's why we repeat lots of things down again, all right? Thank you, Sharon. Sharon says, happy birthday, Chris, for Sunday. Oh, come on. Look, I do. Shall I come closer to the cameras? Look, there we are. Do I look 54 now? I'm sure I do. Look at those lines there, dear. God, it's the oil stuff that I put on my face. I mean, it does make my face shine a bit after I've come out of the swimming pool, but there we are. Oh, dear. Right, hang on, I'll just click a few bits and pieces here. What's that email coming through there? Jason's stuck a picture in showing his tummy off. He says, is it okay to show your tummy off like that? Well, yes, if it's flat. If it's flat. I mean, I can't show my tummy off, and I wish Beyonce wouldn't show hers off. It's horrible. I don't like to see all this pregnancy and pictures and things like that. Cover it up. What's that dress that pregnant ladies used to wear? A smock. That's it. My sister wore a smock when she was pregnant. She didn't start getting naked and putting herself with, you know, and they've got that pose, haven't they? Which I'll do without exposing my stomach. It's this pose. It's this pose. They're like that, aren't they? Look, I can do it. And I'm not even pregnant. Look at that. Isn't that good? Look, I can do that. Look. That's... And they walk up and they think that looks nice. I don't think it does. I really don't. Flat stomach, men or ladies, that's fine. Big stomach, with or without baby, no, dear. I wouldn't get mine out, so please don't get hers out. Dear me. We're going to do today's birthdays now, boys and girls. Happy birthday today to Tom Boak, who's 24 today, who I worked with at Belushi's in London Bridge for quite a few months, a few years ago now. Happy birthday, Tom. Always remember you're my friend, okay? Happy birthday today to Jerome Leff. How am I going to say this? Leff Bevry, I think it is. 38 years old today. Happy birthday, Jerome. Nicolette Street, singing superstar. It's her birthday today. Julian Roper, happy birthday, Julian. Happy birthday to Pete Jones. All these names, I remember you, all of you. Sophie Jean Sutton, 25 today. Happy birthday, Sophie. James Beaumont, 31 today. James, that doesn't look like you. Is that you in the picture? Who is that in the picture, James? That doesn't look like you. 31 today. There's certainly not a 31-year-old in that picture anyway. How old is that person? Probably about 23, 24, something like that. James, happy birthday, James. Sariah Haya. Hello, Sariah. Happy birthday, Sariah. Betty M. Wareham, 30 years old today. Happy birthday, Betty. Oppa Asep. Happy birthday, Oppa. Oppa. Jean Lawler. Jean Lawler. Pamela Darty. Mason. Mason Warren. Hello, Mason. He lives near my sister. He's right up near my sister. Happy birthday, Mason. And Charlotte Peacock, it's her birthday as well. Always a pleasure to see you, Charlotte, darling. So let's sing the song to you, boys and girls. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. All right. Have a lovely Thursday if it's your birthday. Now, being Thursday, I'll be doing a bit of DJing tonight at the Two Brewers in Clapham, if you want to come down there. 10 till 2. It's me late night, and I only do one late night now. 10 till 2. Oh, incidentally, I picked up... In fact, I've completely filled up my Saturdays right up to the end of the year. I've taken some more Saturdays in Central Station, which were offered to me. So I've now filled up every single one of my Saturdays right through until December. So I'm quite pleased about that. If I want holidays, all I have to do is, and I always give people plenty of warning when I'm going away, but I'm really pleased about that. But I still have off, of course, Tuesdays and Sundays. I have most Sundays off. I do one job now on a Sunday. In fact, if you're around in South London on Sunday this week, we've got karaoke and open mic at the Golden Lion in Sydenham. That's this Sunday between 9 p.m. and 12 midnight. I'll disappear now. I'm glad to see that the camera held up for the rest of the show there. Presumably that the mic stayed in sync and everything like that as well. So I'm quite pleased about that. And I shall leave you in peace now. Thanks very much for watching and listening. And I'll see you again very soon. All right. Bye-bye now.